But by all means, just feel free to ask questions at any time. And with that, are there any questions yet? Usually not. We're currently at about 15 people, and we're expecting a full house today, which is really exciting. We're expecting 20 or so folks to join us today, which is really great. Quick review of the agenda. Just to say that we're going to do this interview style. We're just going to hang out and talk a bit about Kanopi Studios and about Mukurtu 2.0. We're going to have a demo. Daniel Washbrook, also from Kanopi, will be joining us to do a demo. And we're going to do a little bit kind of before and after experience. Kelly will also be showing some how things work now and how things we hope will be working soon. And by all means, we'll have an additional Q&A at the end, but if you have questions, feel free to ask. So an intro to Anne and the team, followed by some new features of Mukurtu 2.0, our roadmap going ahead, and hopefully lots of really great questions from you. So with that, what we tend to do, we notice that in today's webinar, over half of you are new, which is really, really exciting. So we want to talk a bit about what we're doing right now. This fall is all about moving towards making Mukurtu 2.0 happen. And again, we stand also, this term keeps coming up, on the shoulders of giants. We've been really fortunate to have fantastic both developer communities and the Drupal community and everyone else helping to make Mukurtu real, and phenomenal support, of course, from Washington State, which has really been leading the charge here. But the most sought after features of Mukurtu to really make it extensible and to really grow it are, one, a really easy way to install. We're going to have a one-click install, literally via a web form. You hit a button and it will install. But there are also a very simple installation profile if you want to install it yourself on your own servers or in some other form of hosted solution. And for that, we're fully committing to having a completely open source version of Mukurtu when it drops in the early part of 2015, both in GitHub and on Drupal.org. We've completely redefined the access protocols and content management system to really respond to the needs that we've been gathering over the last 4 years of this project. And with that, also very near and dear to my personal heart here, a completely redefined archival media management structure where content can live somewhere other than just within the CMS itself. I'll just leave that teaser. We can see some things that will happen. And last week, or 2 weeks ago, we had Mukurtu Mobile, which was a really great session. And Mukurtu Mobile will have a much easier integration with Mukurtu directly. 2015 is our expected drop. It'll probably be somewhere, and then you know there'll be refinements and changes throughout the beginning of the year, but it's going to be a really, really exciting early 2015. Lots of different ways you can be helping. One, you're doing it right now by participating in this. We'll hear from Anne a bit about the user experience sessions that were done and interviews. If you have questions or what you want to be able to contribute, by all means, just reach out. And that's happening, like I said, literally daily. We spend, especially Kelly spends a lot of time just meeting with folks, doing go-to meetings and other ways to really gather your feedback. We will be having formal and informal types of testing coming up, and we'll talk a bit about that too. And we want your help to plan the future. We've had lots of really great ideas about what Mukurtu could be doing. Just a really great conversation around language revitalization in Alaska. So lots of really great ideas. So by all means, we would love your help there. So any questions yet, T-Dog?
Nope.
Nothing other than some shout outs. Great. Well, with that, we're going to jump right in it. And again, Ann, welcome from Kanopi Studios. And is Daniel on the call? Yep. You see him on the list?
Yes.
Excellent.
Hi, Daniel.
Yeah, we got you muted because it's weirdly, if 16 different people try to talk at the same time, it does produce the most amazing effects that you can possibly imagine. So, welcome.
Cool. Thank you. Happy to be here. Thanks for inviting me here today to talk about Mukurtu 2.0. Really excited to be a part of this project. Kanopi was an organization I started not too long ago, and it was really formed on the basis of we work in open source, and we wanted to work with really great people and work on really great projects. We're a distributed company, which means we don't physically have an office. We all work from our own world, whether that's a home, a co-working space, or in our clients' offices. And we've been fortunate to collect a group of individuals that are very talented and have expertise, whether it's in high performance and scalability, whether it's in distribution development, whether it's in design or UX. And while not all of our team members can be here in the city, a lot of them do come for this big event called Bad Camp that I'm also one of the organizers for that event. So I'm very excited.
That doesn't take up any of your time, does it?
No, not at all. Not at all. Especially not at this time of year when it's 2 weeks away. So Kanopi is really excited to be engaged with the Mukurtu 2.0 project. It's exciting because you guys already have a lot of rich data on what's worked and what hasn't. We took a different approach than a traditional website development project where we focus more on starting off with really understanding the user base and then understanding the technology stack that you have, some of the pain points, some of the things that are working well, and then trying to build on that. Just as we all know, Drupal is an open source project and we all get to work on these magical projects thanks to everybody else in the world that's contributing back their work. So having the opportunity to work on a distribution like this where we can do good work and then it can actually be open sourced in the end was just a really magical fit for our team, and they're very jazzed about the project. So the focus has been on the project has really been starting off with this kind of this lean UX approach, which more means like not being bogged down with lots of documentation early on. It means like understanding the users. We did some really rich user interviews, got really strategic, not necessarily what you like about it, but really understanding kind of their what's been easy for them in spinning it up, what's been hard, what they've liked, what they've learned, and then it'll be interesting to kind of take Mukurtu 2.0 in beta and go and user test with that same group of people and help understand if we got some of those pain points. And also keeping the methodology of not worrying about too much about heavy documentation, the plan really is to take our understanding of the Mukurtu 1.0 and bring it up to speed, upgrade it, bring it to, you know, full fruition in terms of the features that are currently working well and replacing the things that aren't working so well. So I know that we're going to talk a little bit more in detail about what some of those things are, but making it easier for the installation process from a user experience standpoint, making it so there's informative content that's preloaded that guides that user. We're working hard, and Pantheon's been dreamy to work with, to get the one-click installation going, so it's really easy for people just to spin up if they're not really technical. And giving better tools so that when someone's coming on board, they can get to a dashboard-like experience and only have what they need, not being overwhelmed with additional choices. And sometimes, as lovely as Drupal is, it can give us some very raw experiences where it exposes things that they don't really need, or, you know, there's some refinement. So in our lean UX process, the goal is to upgrade, bring in Vanessa, who's our user experience strategist, refine it, work with what we have, and then iterate on that. So it's really exciting, and I think that some of the main things that we really want to, you know, really help out here is focusing on that streamlined user experience so that someone who is both non-technical and someone who is both very technical can feel very confident moving forward with the project. You know, for example, right now the theme is a little bit heavy and cumbersome and really hard to work with and not necessarily the most responsive theme. So we're going to strip out the theme and put in a bootstrap responsive theme, fairly bare bones, so that it's very clean and simple for someone that doesn't want to get into the HTML and CSS. But if somebody actually wants to go and add their own theme or even potentially contribute themes back through GitHub, there's going to be that ability to kind of grow the project depending on the skill set of people and their involvement. So
yeah, that's awesome. I mean, I could say about just to latch onto the theming, the front end of Mukurtu as it's currently shipped, if you will, or available, has Bootstrap inserted, and it's allowed us to do some really, really great things, but it's still encumbered because it's kind of trapped within a heavier app because, you know, it was trying to make things happen. So this is our opportunity to make things, you know, really happen kind of for reals.
Totally.
And then in terms of just on the documentation part, I know that our goal is to actually get it out there and get it testing and get it in people's hands, and from there build the documentation. We have our support mukurtu.org site, which is already very rich. But also just wanted to ask another question or feed you a question around Vanessa's discovery with the user interviews. There were some high-level things that come up, but Kelly, by all means, join in too.
Mm-hmm.
But can you talk a bit about some of the things that came up from the users? Because that, to me, was so exciting to hear people say, this is what I love, this is, you know, we really want Mukurtu to work, there's this thing that, if only, or it's killing my brain, or everything in between.
Yeah, I think a lot of that really, you know, came down to, we were trying to find patterns in terms of the pain points, because some people have an easier time with the installation than others, and a lot of it was just getting going, figuring out where to go, and there's an abundance of information out there, and it's just helping them guide through that, because a lot of people necessarily don't read a lot of documentation and per se, so creating more help text on screen, and I believe there was a lot of outcomes where there was a lot of pain points in terms of the media management stuff, and that kind of came up over and over again as a theme, so looking at making that a lot easier. So the interviews were really rich, and I think that we had the opportunity to speak with people that had been working with Mukurtu for a long time and had a lot of the tribal knowledge of knowing how and what to do versus some new users that hadn't been with it too long and could share some fresh experiences of the whole startup process. So, but yeah, I think that's a really rich opportunity to blend with Daniel, who's our technical lead on the project, who could then really understand, okay, these are the pain points, how can we solve that? And there's some technical components of it that when we're looking at doing this, like you said, we're standing on the shoulders of giants, is what is coming out of the box? And sometimes, like we said, it's very Drupal-y. So then regrouping around some of those user stories to find out, okay, if user X is using it like this, does this technology fit that need, and how can we make it easier and more accessible and less overhead? They can just kind of get to do what they need to do. So, I don't know, Daniel, do you have, I think you got unmuted.
And Daniel, are you unmuted now?
Yeah.
Yay, Daniel. Welcome. Excellent. Do you have anything quickly to add? I'm gonna have, Kelly's going to ask some more amazing questions, I'm sure. But how's it been for you?
I mean, I'm fascinated by all of the facets that Mukurtu encompasses, and working on it. There are so many components, and especially what came out of Vanessa's user experience interviews. There's so many things that we could do. It's really just picking the most amazing ones. And so I'm really excited to show some of the ones that we've got in the oven at the moment and talk about some of the potentials coming down the pipeline.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Thoughts?
I had a couple questions, which I think Anne probably already answered. So just to give everybody a background, we started working with Kanopi, in August, probably?
Yeah, we did a full request for proposal and went in.
Mm-hmm.
It was a very competitive process, and we were just, it was really the user experience part and your reputation, but the user experience philosophy that you brought to it, there's like, okay, that's
mm-hmm.
awesome. Good. We got to go with this.
Mm-hmm.
But
right.
Yeah, sorry.
No, that's great. That's exactly what I was going to say. So it was really the user experience that really we were like, this is what we need, because so many people are having difficulty just getting started. And I feel like once there's that, Vanessa calls it the aha moment,
mm-hmm.
Where they kind of get to learn what's going on with cultural protocols and communities and how they intersect and interact, that's when users really start to use their systems, but a lot of times it gets abandoned because it's just so it's such a steep learning curve at this point. But some of the things we've talked about in our meetings seem like it's really going to be not so steep anymore. It's going to be just getting going. And the webinars have helped people through getting started with Mukurtu. And anytime somebody gets signed up, I send them to our webinar season one, episode one, there's when I start the demo, because
it's lots to digest.
Yeah,
it's lots to digest. It's lots to digest.
And it's really helped me as well be able to explain what's going on with the cultural protocols and the communities. So,
mm-hmm.
Yeah,
often working with Drupal is something that, I mean, all of us that work in Kanopi have at least 6 years of professional experience working in Drupal, so we understand some of those pain points just from working in this technology. And understanding it from the human's perspective of like, okay, I'm a functional user. I don't know maybe what a node or an entity, or I don't know what organic groups mean. That's okay. You don't actually need to know any of that to run your Mukurtu site, and making it so that they, when they don't hit things, they're not getting confused. So I know Vanessa takes a, like, how can we make those aha moments come a lot sooner? And how do we take a user from a novice to an expert? And how do we guide them so that they don't feel like they have to do a lot of Googling or figuring out? Like, they're naturally guided through that process. So it's really exciting to see some of the stuff that the Drupal community's already done. You know, without getting too technical, some of the core conversations we had was around what parts of the functionality do we replace, rebuild, and one of the main thing that drives a lot of the content access and display of the groups on how communities can connect is through something called organic groups. And the Drupal community itself has done so much work on that module that us being able to leverage that work gives us more time to spend on other things. Instead of ripping that out and having to build a whole new groups functionality, we're able to stand on the shoulder of giants and work on other fundamental things, like this dashboard that we're going to talk about today, and the media asset management, which is becoming, is really going to be cool, because Drupal has been known for some of its challenges around media management. And
such nice John words. it has been hard, for sure. And it is an interesting thing. We were ready to abandon organic groups because of things we heard in terms of rumors of where it was going to go, but through this process of discovery, we did an extensive discovery phase of really going through, and what we talk about lightweight documentation in terms of what, I think you're really describing the experience day to day of working in Mukurtu, the software.
Mm-hmm.
Behind the scenes, there've been hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of pages back and forth, and lots of drive, lots and lots of stuff. But it was through that discovery phase that actually Daniel came up with, some more hardcore testing and seeing how things are now in terms of the updates, and we had some really interesting discoveries, which have led to, as we say here, a redefined, but not abandoned, but redefined and much more improved protocol and content management structure.
We're also big advocates of, like, let's build out prototypes as early as possible, because sometimes, drawing a wireframe of how media asset management is going to work is too flat.
Yeah.
So we've been able to like spin up small demos where we've been able to functionally test, will this suit the needs of the user? Will this suit the needs? So we're going to do some of those demos here shortly and show you. It's very naked in terms of what it has in. It's not totally baked into a full Mukurtu demo. But it'll allow us to at least see some of the core functionality, which we're going to then layer on top another, making sure that the language that's used in those tools are really easy and friendly to work with. So yeah,
it's a great transition to demoing to the users what the Mukurtu experience is like right now, and then maybe we can jump into some of Daniel's stuff.
Okay.
Yeah. So what we're gonna do, saying this is great, we're definitely getting better at the timing. So it's only 11:20, which is great. So we have some good time. So what we're gonna do is I'm gonna hand over I'm gonna move the presenter over to, as we call it, Coda Camera B here, and hand it over to Kelly, and she's gonna walk us through the experience now of how things work with Mukurtu, which isn't a bad experience, but we want to make it a much more rich experience. But one of the things I'm really excited about that you're going to see today is features that just don't exist in Mukurtu at all, but have to exist if Mukurtu is really going to be an archival platform, which was its whole point. So let's try this. We're going to go to, you know what? You can go ahead and grab the presenter. Grab it too, and have it be
me.
Yeah.
Okay.
If you're listening, go to training. When you do a training, it'd be really great if you did make every one of our presenters the same person in the future, because that would be helpful.
Everyone can see my screen. That's great. So today I'm actually using Mukurtu Mobile because it's just such an exciting website and a great place to learn about mobile. And I'm going to show you a little bit about adding media to content and the dashboard, because Daniel's going to go into some demos of the new workflow. So first off, I'll just go into Browse, and I'm logged in as a librarian, which is the same role that everyone in Premier has. So you'll be able to see what some of the functions are for that role and when you're in Premier. So adding a digital heritage item, typically we have a little plus digital heritage at the top here. I'm just going to go to content and click add digital heritage. And as you know, that as most of you probably know, there's a lot of metadata that can go into a digital heritage item, like a title and some of the required fields like communities, cultural protocols, and categories. And then a whole lot more that we could go into, but we won't do that now. So adding media to a digital heritage item is pretty straightforward sometimes. You select media, and a little window pops up, and you can upload a file from your location, from the web, or from the media library, which will never load because my role doesn't allow for that. so we'll upload from my desktop. I have an image ready. So we'll choose file, desktop, and here we go. This slide should look familiar. And it submits a little thumbnail here, so we can go along and add a title, and web public art, and whichever category. General. And that's the minimum that we can add to add a digital heritage item. But it's really just set up to feature one digital heritage, one piece of media at a time. There are options to add multiple media, but they kind of get pushed aside. And there's not a lot of a curation aspect. If I was to add a media item to the body, I'd need to know how to put that in HTML into the description. So I think our new media solution is going to help with that a lot. And the second pain point was the dashboard, especially for myself, because the dashboard is great because it's the single place that you can go to do pretty much everything that you'll want to do with your Mukurtu site just straight out of the box. But it's not set up in a very good workflow. It can be a lot to absorb if you're just getting started in Mukurtu. And so the other thing is that it's the same for every single user. So because I'm a librarian, I'm not going to be able to go change the site name and slogan and email address, but I still get that option. So it's kind of like you're dangling candy in front of my face and I can't eat it, which is kind of relevant for me because I'm not eating sugar right now. So you can you see everything, and it's the new way that we have the dashboard set up. It's very modular, and Daniel will actually show you some of that right now.
All right.
So yeah, do you want me to?
Yeah.
Do you want me to take it over and walk you through?
Let me. Are you ready for me to give you the presenter role?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. By all means, if you have any questions at all, don't be shy. Just pop them in there. We are definitely paying attention.
Yeah, if you can shout out any questions that pop up while I'm doing this, and I can stop and go back over it. Now, it's really important to keep in mind that this is a naked demo. You'll have to use your imagination to make it look as beautiful as the Mukurtu mobile site does right now. And it's more about raw functionality and what we can get in. And we're trying to reduce points of friction with the current setup so that you can access and manage data faster and better. So this is a screen of adding an asset. So what Kelly was just talking about, a digital heritage item. A digital heritage item has all of the extra metadata that go along with an asset. And an asset, in this case, we'll use images. But they can really be anything from videos to audio clips, all the way to we started to see that an asset can even be a Twitter post, that might have, say, a language that doesn't get used anymore or an image inside of that Twitter post. So the digital assets realm is getting very broad, you could say. So where Kelly was just adding images, we have the same kind of interface where you can pick an image, and in this case, it'll upload. You can hit it, and it'll upload automatically. But you can also drag and drop them in here, and you could do multiple images right in here. And we'll do a tag for a test, and Mukurtu can be the author. And the only reason I'm filling those in is because they're going to be important in a moment when we see how we can interact with these assets when we're creating digital heritage items. All right, well, we waited too long for that one, so I'll go into my next big, my pre-baked one. And so this is a very, very slimmed down digital heritage item. And so the asset got uploaded, everything's ready to go, and you pick your communities, and we're working on this interface a fair bit. But then when you get down to where you attach the actual asset, you have this little drawer on the side. And this drawer has the asset I just uploaded, per se. And from there, I can drag it right into where I want the asset to go. But I can also add multiple versions, multiple assets. So if one is, say, a very small JPEG and another one is a gigantic original TIFF, they can all be managed all through this one interface. And you also get, so I can drag in my video that goes with my JPEG right here. But I can also edit the asset right through this interface. So it opens up a little pop-up. Where I get to see that the title of my asset, the image, I can remove it and put up a new image. I can also control, and this is an important feature, that I can control the community access to this specific asset. So not only does the digital heritage item get a community reference to it, but the asset itself, so that I can ensure that only users of that community have access to this asset. And then the last little piece when you're editing an asset, there's a little bit more granularity to the access control, where I can let other people edit this asset if I want, but I can also control whether or not they can drag it in. So even though you'd be able to see this asset in my digital heritage item, you might not be able to add it to your digital heritage item when you go create one. So at least this leaves that access in the hands of the author. And if I wasn't the author for these items, you wouldn't see the delete or the edit. And if I hadn't checked fetch, the other people wouldn't see insert as well.
Yeah, that's
and
great. And these are all new functions that just didn't exist at all.
Yeah. And being that this is very naked Drupal, we're now going to go and do a layer of UX work where we're looking at what types of language makes most sense to the end user.
Absolutely.
And refining some of the help text on screen so that they do know that they can have these functions and features right there without having to look for additional help.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. And I also have a very refined down, when we were talking about a bootstrap theme, this is a digital heritage item, as Kelly showed it, without any of the theming applied on top. Because one of the things I wanted to show is how this can apply to some of the more content-related fields, like, I think you said narrative was a common one, cultural narrative.
Yeah.
So we could essentially include an asset right into the body of a cultural narrative just by dragging and dropping things. And then it's fully editable.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Right.
And I assume that could also be an audio or a video file?
Yeah, so if I don't have a video in this one, but if
sorry.
I grab a video file, this one, it drops the video right in, and it brings, in this case, this is a YouTube video, so it brings the YouTube embed code. Or if it was Vimeo, it would bring the Vimeo embed code so that the user on the end would be able to see it. But the option to store the video on your server is also there, and in which case, it will embed the link to the file with the player wrapped around it so that you get a nice video experience, just like you would from YouTube, but you get the security of having the file on your server.
Yeah, we're definitely gonna, as I say, we're going to talk a bit more about that particular thing spend a little time.
That is a whole conversation. And I'm trying to be very careful to not go down any tangents.
No, you're great.
So
we'll rabbit hole it after. But just, I see Chris Mule just also said nice. This feature of being able to have a traditional knowledge or cultural narrative actually be a narrative, or have it be a video, or have it be a song, now we have that. And that's just fantastic. That's just going to be really, really great.
Definitely. And I mean, right away you notice that as soon as you get more than 10 items in this list, it'll become cumbersome to navigate through. And that's where there's a search bar that pulls out. And you can search by type, by tags, by when it was uploaded, and reduce this list to a much more manageable set. So really you can go by image, filter it down.
That's awesome.
We'll pretend it's a little bit faster.
I understand, Mark.
With the downsides of running a demo while screen sharing. There
we go. Yay. Nice.
Okay, so we had a couple questions.
Okay, fire away.
We have from Chris Webster, do you have to drag the asset back on after editing, or does editing change the one that was already dragged in?
So it depends on where you drag it to. If you drag it into an asset spot like the one shown here, then editing it would reflect right away in this spot because it's really just a reference. But if we change some of the metadata in the cultural narrative after we've dragged it across, like here this is just plain text, so this plain text won't get updated, but that just came with it. But if we change, say, the source of the video, that would... It depends. And the narratives, they become a little bit more static. So in a sense, when they've been dragged into the box up here, then yeah, they'll get updated. If they get dragged into the narrative, it really depends on what got changed.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, that's without geeking out, basically what you're saying, I mean, it's pulling whatever metadata, whatever data has been attached to it, a YouTube or Vimeo in that case, for sure there. But this also points out that you can have now a digital heritage item is much more dynamic because it can be about that asset, but it can also be about the store, and it can be about both. And if you, and I think there's another question from Julie that had also to do about changing the title to the item. So you want to ask that question, or what is Julie asking there?
So the question is, can the title of the asset be changed as well? It looked like the title could be edited from test 3 to another title, perhaps refined.
And just pulling up. So yeah, here I could change it to. And as slowly as it will, it'll update the change in the drawers up here.
Gives us more time to talk.
It won't change the reference down here. Wait for it. There we go. So the title changed while this one didn't. And up here, it won't show the change now, but if we save this digital heritage item, it would reflect the change that we made here.
Okay.
Well, what you just described is actually a definite feature, because if you create an item with a story, with an asset, with this title, and we're informing that asset at that moment, I don't want to go back later and have it be a different title in terms of that story. So that's actually a good archival process. So I think that's the reason why it does that, which is good. There's a secondary question now from Chris Butcher.
Yeah. So to take it a step further, you could have the asset in many places and edit it once and have the change reflect across all the places where that is possible.
Absolutely. And I think a really good use case that Michael brought up a while ago is when you have a video asset and a thumbnail attached to it. If you decide later on you want to change the thumbnail image that gets shown in, say, lists of digital heritage items, you don't have to go into every instance of that digital heritage item. You just have to change the original asset that it came from.
All right.
Yeah, that is so huge. I mean, one of the things just to remind us about, I don't know, 3 years ago. So you'd pre-retina displays, you'd make your thumbnails a certain size, and then they came up with the retina display. Apple just came up with their 5,000 pixel widescreen last week. So you might want to go back and make a new thumbnail, and you can actually do that, which is fantastic. Really, really cool.
Definitely.
Sweet.
Awesome.
Well, we'll come back to this. You had a couple more things to talk about, right?
I wanted to do a quick walkthrough of what the dashboard, and this one is even more raw, so I should extra forewarn that this is really showing what the functionality is going to be. But the process that we're going through for user experience is to figure out, first, we want to get this functionality into the dashboard. Then we need to figure out what needs to be in the dashboard for each kind of user. So for a librarian versus an administrator, you're going to need access to very different information, and we need to reduce friction on different actions that they're going to be taking. So that process hasn't happened yet, because as we're going through a lean UX piece, we're first going to build all these functionalities like the asset management system, and then we're going to figure out how to make them very usable and very easy to interact with. So this is its dashboard, and the key part that we want to take away from this is its dynamic ability. So picturing yourself as a user and you're coming to your system, you get to see live data. So who's just signed up? Who's online right now? What's the recent content that was created? But this is the stuff that comes out of the box with Google. The pieces that we're looking at building next are items like a really quick way to turn on and off the ability for mobile devices to connect to your Mukurtu archival system. And instead of having to go through a 4-page tutorial on setting this up, we'll create a little on-off switch here. But once you've set certain things up, like turning on or setting the site name, you don't need to keep that box in here anymore. And so you can start closing them. You can close an item. You can minimize an item. You can move them around just by dragging them so that you can set up your dashboard the way you like it. And the beauty of this as well is that the whole Drupal community can create blocks that can go in here. So if we miss something, really somebody needs a block that does something completely different, you can get a developer with a very moderate level of Drupal experience to create that block, and then you could decide to just have it show up right in the top and then drag it into where you want it to be. And then if at some point you end up in a situation where you've closed a block or you've hidden something and you want it to come back, you can always go back to the defaults that we set up originally with the system. So restore the dashboard, and it goes back to the original settings. And the idea also being that each type of user will get a different dashboard with different functionality built into it. And that way we can alleviate, like Kelly said, where she sees access to things like setting the site name when you're just trying to add digital heritage items.
Great.
So, yeah.
This is, again, as you said, it's very, very raw and naked, but it is going to be so amazing. And correct me if I'm wrong, or when I'm wrong, as I like to say around here, maybe when I'm wrong, but, because I'll get it wrong eventually, but it's based on user role, right?
Yes. Yeah, exactly. So a librarian will get one dashboard and an administrator will get a different dashboard, and they'll have different blocks to choose from in this list, and we'll have different preset blocks.
So we wouldn't have the situation as Kelly just demoed as where you click on this thing and it says you can't do it because it just wouldn't be there to begin with.
Exactly.
Which is really
and the other thing too is with someone with a little bit of time, they can create custom dashboards entirely for users of their system. So if they feel that the dashboard templates that we've set up don't work, they can go in and check the boxes of the blocks they want to add and where they want them to show up by default. And then they basically just change the URL or change the access permissions for that dashboard. So you can have multiple dashboards working all over your site.
Whoa. That's out of my brain. That's great. Wow. Fantastic. So where do you want to go next? We're at 11:40, which is great.
Right on time.
Yeah.
I'll take back.
Should we take back control? You got other...
Nope, that's the sum of the really cool parts that I've got in the cooker right now.
All right. Fantastic. Oh, wait, there is one more thing.
Oh.
And I'm not trying to be that guy that says there's one more thing, but okay, I just did. Where is your content being stored, Daniel?
As far as at, like, digital media assets or
yeah.
straight content?
The assets are being added.
In this case, I switched. So originally, we were storing it on a third-party server called Amazon S3. And Amazon is the backbone of a lot of websites now, especially like Facebook. They store all their images and assets there. And the idea being that if you don't have to store it on your server, you can keep exact archival copies of it. You can keep high-resolution versions of it. But this is an option for users that want to go down that road. And it's sometimes called a proxy, sometimes called a CDN. And in some ways, it can make accessing assets faster as well, because we can keep them closer to the user base. But in this case, I did actually switch it back, because it's slightly slower when you're creating assets, because it uploads them through the site and up to Amazon. But for the final version of the Mukurtu 2.0, we'll have a way that it'll upload it straight to Amazon, so it'll be much faster.
Yeah, so, I mean, this thing, though, what you just described is so huge. And because, I mean, so Netflix runs on Amazon S3, Dropbox runs on Amazon S3, so much of the functionality of the internet runs on Amazon S3. I personally love it from an archival perspective and a privacy security perspective, because you can really lock it down in a lot of great ways, which is also super important. Also, Amazon, the storage wars are huge. A terabyte of storage is $10 a month. Terabyte, which is just absolutely fantastic. DuraCloud, which is a archival quality repository software, is built also on S3. But one of the most important things we have, and we have a Canadian right here in the room, is many organizations we work with worldwide have to be able to say, my server is here, and we can actually say that your content is, in fact, in your country. And also with our partnership with Pantheon, that's the same kind of promise we're getting, which is to say we can actually, for the first time, you'll be able to have your content be somewhere. It's got a really ugly name. They call it the bucket, but basically the bucket of your content can be stored where you want it to be. So I see this as huge. And as much energy as there is around Drupal, if you put that on the S3 platform, you can just multiply that by about 100,000 or more. I couldn't even imagine the math, because everyone who's trying to deliver content to your living room every night is trying to build better services on S3. So this is a huge thing for us. I think it's going to be really great.
Yeah, and it's also dynamic in the sense that you can use S3, or you can also connect it to other S2 compliant services like Google Cloud.
Yeah, so we're starting with S3 for reasons that Daniel, I'm sure, will be happy to talk about. But in terms of complexity, and because it is so well kind of thought out right now, Chris asked a question about the storage capacity limit per account. The answer to that is it's only as limited as how much you want to pay. So that's the thing that's beautiful about it, because at that price point, a terabyte for $10 a month, and if you want to have 10, then it's not 100. So
yeah, and the pricing is a little bit more, all like there's more caveats, because there's also they charge you for transferring so they charge you for storage and for transferring.
They do. So you know, if you're saying that's a whole another thing, but it is true. If your site is incredibly popular, you will pay more. But that's another thing that's really exciting, is the idea that ultimately it will happen in 2.0, but it will happen eventually, where the web quality optimized content that people are using, the what we call the representational content, that's the content that would be served out, and then you have a deeper archival layer that's safe, and we can even use things in Amazon called Glacial, which is a very, very inexpensive cloud layer. Love to talk about that. We're going to do a whole episode in the spring. In
cloud computing for Mukurtu.
We have to do it. There's so much energy around it, and it's so critically important. Is, well, where is my stuff? It comes up all the time. Where are we? Let's see.
There's no presenter right now, but.
All right. Let's bring this back up, and 11:47. Are there any other key questions at the moment? Pick that one up. That's our guest from last time.
Oops.
That's okay. I can see more members of our team. So, Anne, do you have other things you want to add? taken through the process? Do you want to tell us a bit about the timing and how things are going? And we'd like to hear more about just the overall process and how you work, and maybe a bit more about what you mean by kind of your lean UX or whatever.
Sure, yeah. So I think we're in a place where we try to do really functional documentation, do good stakeholder user interviews. We've gone through the measure twice, cut once approach, where we really want to make sure that when we get into development, we're doing the right types of activities. And now Daniel's in a phase where he's taking and he's working on doing some fundamental upgrades. We're working on the one-click installation with Pantheon. Without getting too technical, we're upgrading the organic groups. We're implementing the media asset management. And then Vanessa's going to loop back in about 2 weeks, and we're going to start looking at some of the functionality in terms of language and nomenclature and how to make it easier so that on the one-click installation, there is a couple of steps that you need once you've spun it up on Pantheon, and how to set up and what content is to be the dummy content or the informational content that's going to guide the user on adding their own user base and cultural protocols and digital heritage items. So that's really going to be an interesting intersection where we bring tech and UX back together and meld, because we have created such a solid understanding and foundation to which to grow from. And as soon as we get there, we then can look at what other, you know, for example, we may also reach out to our users again and ask them about on the dashboard, now that we know that we can do these five things, you know, get some user feedback on what would be the most useful from both our current knowledge and just like really, Lean UX pretty much means like we like to test often. We don't want to build too much and get into a little silo where we think we know what's going on. We want to build, test, iterate. And that's going to be the process that we go through throughout the end. And when we get to a good place, hopefully in early December, you know, it'll be an excellent time to probably regroup with the community at large and have the community say, what about this? And how does it work like that? And, you know, getting that some of that live feedback, even in this situation, is going to be really skillful and key. So, you know, in the next couple of weeks, we'll have some good demos internally, and I'm sure Michael and the team will kind of bring you guys up to speed through the webinars on the progress and some of the wins that we've had. Again, when we're standing on these shoulders of giants, it means that we're also, if we find a bug or something in the media module that's called Scald or Organic Groups, we'll be committing, you know, patches we'll be submitting issues in the issue queue, and thankfully these are very well-maintained active modules that the community will also help build on. So it goes along with the whole philosophy of why Drupal's been such a good choice, is we really want to leverage our open source community. Which is exciting because Vanessa's coming down here for Bad Camp in just a couple of weeks. So we're going to be able to powwow in person. Being that we are virtual, we take these opportunities to all get together in person and talk about next steps. So it'll be really exciting to have her here for that as well. She can't be here because of her some personal things that are going on right now. So she's here in spirit, though.
Yeah, and she is amazing. So Bad Camp is Bay Area Drupal Camp.
The Drupal community changed my life. I fundamentally was working in the marketing agency space, and it was awful. The high stress, high deadlines, really intense. And I fell into Drupal by accident about 6-7 years ago. And it was my experience at, it was actually at the San Francisco Drupal Con. And that was when I started to fall in love with the Bay Area and the community down here. And about 4 years ago, I volunteered as a volunteer to just help out with the camp. And then for the last 3 years, I've been working with Matt Cheney, Jen Lambton, Crystal Williams, Kate Miller, and a whole bunch of volunteers. So if anybody wants to come down to the Palace of Fine Arts and experience Drupal firsthand and learn about any of this stuff, we'll be down there. It should be one of our biggest, most magical events of the year.
It is amazing. It was the deciding vote, if you will, for making the decision to go with Drupal for Mukurtu when all Mukurtu had at the time was a scratch of funding from a National Endowment for Humanities Starter Grant.
Mm-hmm.
And I met Matt Cheney there, and he's like, yeah, and you know what? You should come to this thing we're about to do. It's called Pantheon. And I'm about to announce it. And, you know, he's just a great guy, very kind of relaxed. And then he gets out there and he puts on his presentation mode, and he goes, I want that. And now Pantheon has become just such a phenomenal thing. And I have one quick announcement about Pantheon. Do you know that Pantheon is now 40% faster?
I'm very excited about that.
Pantheon kind of like S3 runs like one giant organism. It's like the Borg. It's one big thing. Borg in a good way. And they actually went through and replaced all of the drives into SSD drives. So the whole platform runs.
Yeah.
It's incredible. Really exciting. Stuff.
Yeah, Kanopi as a Pantheon partner, we do a lot of our site development on Pantheon. It's very easy for us to contribute and to work together on projects. It's absolutely does amazing things for our clients that want to have some of the tools like Apache Solr, which is a rich search engine, and they want to have some of the high performance stuff taken care of. That all comes out of the box. Development is set up for us in a way that we have a good production workflow. So I think it's excellent that we're going to be able to do this as a one-click installation. I've worked on some other distributions on getting that up and running on Pantheon, and it makes it a lot easier for the non-technical people to get engaged with Drupal, because setting up Drupal on a server can be a bit cumbersome and can be a bit tricky. So having that ability just to be like, boom, click, and then have some nice guidance along to get up, we'll see a really good, you know, less attrition, right? We really want to see people that spin this up, stick with it and use it and recommend it and build out their community on it, whether that's and what's interesting about Mukurtu is it can expand far beyond what it's even doing now, just the way it's storing assets and allowing people, even if it's families, archiving their family assets, right? There's lots
of ways to go there. A dream for sure.
Yeah.
You know, we talked about it a bit before the episode here. And our dream, certainly my dream, I started working on this 4 years ago, was that in 4 years, we won't even recognize Mukurtu. Well, we still do, but I think now, I brought this slide back up because most people, first of all, haven't had an opportunity to experience one-click install, but Kelly has got to experience it hundreds of times. Mm-hmm. We've started hundreds and hundreds of sites now on Pantheon. At one time, we were the largest user of Pantheon in terms of individual sites. And but what we want is that experience of just you go in, you go to Mukurtu.org or Mukurtu.net, and you hit a button and you fill out this form, and it just doesn't dump you into like, oh my God, I'm in Drupal world, which is fine if you're a Drupal person,
yeah.
But if you're just trying to get things done, it can be a bit challenging. It's going to be I think a really amazing experience for people.
Yeah.
And just a little bit more detail there, because we haven't really talked about this much, but you get that opportunity to, the site really is yours. I mean, that's the thing that we feel so strongly about this, and that's our motto is it's yours. Our legal standpoint, our terms of service are literally two words, it's yours, by a lawyer. So, you know, you have your own development and test and live environments, your own keys, your own security, your own protocols, and that's how this thing all works. That's what's really, really great. And then I just wanted, we talked a little bit, we have a couple minutes left about these are terms that perhaps many people who are watching right now and listening to us may not even understand, just because they have lives that aren't necessarily geeky. But can you talk a bit about why GitHub and Drupal.org are great and awesome and useful for what we want to do together?
Yeah, totally. You know, if Daniel's still available, he would probably be like, Daniel does a great job. Essentially, it's
yeah, definitely.
Cool.
Tell us what's awesome about that.
Well, the idea behind, I mean, there's so many geeky reasons why GitHub is cool and version controlling software. I mean, basically, the gist of it being you can look back and see every change that a developer has made to code. And then going forward, you can collaborate on code because the only things that come together are the differences. But then when we start to look at collaborative environments where we might not even know the other developers, you can do something called doing a fork, which is where you take someone's code base and you make your own copy of it, and it's yours to work on. And then if you come up with something really cool in your code base and you want to contribute it back to the original, you can do what's called a pull request, which is a really simple way of saying, hey, I've got this code, you can take a look at it, give it a test, and if you like it, merge it back in with yours. And for an organization like Mukurtu, like I was saying on the dashboards, someone else might have a better idea of a block that could go into that dashboard. So they could do a pull request to the Mukurtu base and say, hey, I made this really neat block that combines these things or goes out and does this with the internet, and it might be really handy. And then we at Mukurtu can look at it and decide if it's something that's worthwhile being included in our version, or if it's something that's better as a standalone, that's something that someone else wants to add on, and we might just reference it. So having an organized a code repository like GitHub lets us merge those things together, as well as reference out to other things as submodules, saying that, hey, you might be interested in what this guy is doing, or I like this, so I'm going to flag it. All of these things come together, and then you can host your code on the Drupal.org website where other Drupal developers get access to it. And it's essentially all free for using it, the stipulation being that you make source code available as you distribute it. But it makes it available, and then we can take those repositories and put them on Pantheon so that other people can just spin up their sites. They don't have to worry about messing with the code. They can go onto Pantheon, say, I want a Mukurtu site as well, hit a button, and it installs it on Pantheon. And Pantheon being a hosting environment, there you go, you've got a website, and you don't even have to worry about what's going on in the background.
You're right.
Yeah.
That was perfect. Yeah, it is great. I mean, just yesterday we were talking with Gary Holt from the Alaska Native Language Archive about language revitalization and capabilities that can happen there. And he said, what Alaska needs, and I have family up there, it's near and dear to my heart, is as a state or a country, depending on who you ask, is a community around language revitalization. And that's what, again, is so exciting about Drupal, because Drupal is an international worldwide community. So someone might come up with a particular thing that works for a particular dialect of a particular language that may not necessarily be useful if you're working in Thailand, and it's a, say it's Spanish or something. So being able to have those types of capabilities may not necessarily be committed to the full fork or the full master code base of Mukurtu, but would be there. And that's what I'm saying. I think in 5 years, we're going to be saying, we won't recognize Mukurtu. It will be something completely,
mm-hmm.
we would hope, completely transformed.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's definitely the goal. Right?
Yeah, that's how Drupal has been, like from working on it back in the days of 4.6 and where it is with now beta 8 out. It's absolutely phenomenal and what the power of the collective can do. And having opportunities to contribute, whether it's through our professional agreement, like services where we can help a client like this and contribute back, whether it's all the volunteer efforts that go into setting up sprints and setting up the ability for people actually to come into one place and collaborate together. It's the sum of many that makes projects like this possible, that makes Drupal even possible, that makes a lot of these things. So when looking at a lot of different ways to manage your content, Drupal is definitely the most robust in terms of making it easy to manage from a layman to a very technical person. And we're only going to see that grow as Drupal 8 comes out. So,
yeah, and we have to go, but that's a whole other episode we'll want to do in the spring for sure, because there are the major things that they want to do in 8 are so appealing to what we want to do. But for now, we have to say goodbye, and I just want to give a great shout out for Tyler over here on camera. See here, he's been taking copious notes. I think he's about 18 pages in. We will post the notes. We'll be posting the episode up. And we really thank you very much for everyone who's writing. Really encourage your questions and your participation. And thank you again. Thank you very much. And just to remind you again, we'll be having our Badcamp episode in 2 weeks,
mm-hmm.
Which is really exciting, with Kalamunu, who will be collaborating some other great work together, which is super exciting. And please stay tuned, and thank you very much, and we'll see you around.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Bye, guys.
Excellent.